Okay. After we determine the metric B already, after we have metric B, that is, we use the coordinate x, y. We use coordinate x, y for each node. Determine alpha, beta, and gamma. We can determine for shape function. We can determine metric B and also shape function. In order to determine the area of element, if the area of the element is easy to determine from the coordinate, it's not necessary to use this formulation. This formula is for the case that the area of the element is not in general form that you can find as the from the basic formula of the area of triangular, that is a half time height and time base. Okay, so if we can find from that, it's easy to use that way. Okay, but if we cannot, so for the case that it is a general shape of triangular, we can use this formula also. Okay. Then after we have the shape function, then we can determine for the body force. The body force is defined, is mean that the actually the body force that we familiar with is the weight density. For example, it is a weight density. But it has a lot of types of the body force. There is maybe the centrifugal force, the initial force, or something that we may have to solve in dynamic problem. For that case, the body force is the force per unit volume. When we apply, when we would like to apply this body force to the element, we have to determine it by integrate this force by using this equation, the equation one, integrate over volume. But because when we integrate this force by using the centroid at the centroid, when we set up the coordinate at the centroid of the element, we found that by definition of the centroid, this is the integrate of x, the coordinate at centroid, and y over the area is equal to zero. So it can conclude that after we determine the body force by using this equation, after we derive it by creating the integration over the volume, we may conclude that the body force at node I can be determined by using the body force vector multiplied with the thickness of the element multiplied with the area over 3. Okay, that is a general formula in order to find the body force at node I. In the same manner, for the body force at node A and node M, we can determine it in the same manner, and we can conclude that for the body force of the element that is distributed to this node, this three node, node I, node J, and node M, we can, using this formula, that is the body force XB, body force vector for each node, okay, multiply with the area times thickness over 3, this is for body force. Okay, if we would like to determine the surface force, for the case that the thickness is the unit value, the surface force is maybe mean that it is like a distributed load. Okay, in order to determine the surface force on the concentrated triangular elements, we can use this formula to to dispute the load, the surface force to the node, to the node of that side. Okay, we integrate it over the surface. But because the surface area, according to this, we apply the shape function and surface traction or the surface pressure apply to that side. For example, like this example, this is the distributed surface force, distributed load. That is a uniform load. If we consider the load applied to the element number one, that is the connected with the node number one, number two, and number three. And the load is the surface force is applied to the size of node number one and number three. So according to this, we can evaluate the surface force and chain it to the equivalent nodal force. That is, after we integrate, substitute the formula into the formula of the shape function and also the pressure, that for this case, it has just only the x direction. You integrate over the surface of that side, that is the dc and dy, because we consider the force, the surface force applied to the area over dc and dy. And the direction of the surface force is in the x direction. So we evaluate it at x equal to a and y equal to y. Y equal to any y, but x equal to a. So if we consider here, we set up the coordinate at point 2 for element number 1, okay? We set the coordinate at point 2 for local coordinate, okay? So the surface 1 at node 1, 3, the x coordinate is equal to a, okay? But y coordinate is any point. Is any point. It's any point. So according to this, we evaluate the shape function. The shape function by substitute x equal to a and y equal to y. Okay. So according to this, after we simplify this equation, we can find that the surface force can be determined by integrate these vector, that is n1p, n2p, n3p, but the force in y direction is equal to zero because the pressure is equal to zero. The surface force in y direction is equal to zero. So we integrate over y by using the shape function that we already know. We obtain from alpha, beta, and gamma. Okay. After we derive it from this formula, okay, alpha I, for this example, it means that alpha I equal to xj ym. This is the formula minus yj xm. When we determine for I equal to 1, okay, j equal to 2 and m equal to 3. So it means that alpha I can be determined by this. We substitute the coordinate into this formula. For this example, we found that alpha I becomes 0, alpha 1 becomes 0, beta 1 becomes 0 also, and gamma 1 is equal to a. So we found that N1 equal to AY over 2A for this case. And we do the same thing. We found that N2 equal to L A minus X over 2A and N3 equal to LX minus AY over 2A. Okay. By substitute this formula, by substitute this formula into the equation that we have done it before, we can conclude that the surface force distributed on the node is equal to this equation, equation 18. And then after we integrate with respect to y, we obtain this. Okay. And then for the from this, when we simplify the final solution of this, we can find that the surface force after we simplify this value, when we multiply each term together, we found that the equivalent nodal force that is derived from the surface, the uniform surface force is equal to PLT over 2. That is actually this makes sense. That is a half of the total sum of the surface force. PLT over 2 is distributed to each node on that side. Okay, so according to that, if we consider the overall problem for the overall problem, and we consider the size that is subject to the surface force, that surface force, so we can find that the surface force distributed to the size of 1, 3, and 3, 4 is equal to PL over 2 for node 1, node 3, and node 4. And for node 3, we have 2 value of the surface force that distribute to it because it is the middle node of this side. So for node number 3, the surface force, the equivalent nodal force come from the surface force is become PLT, okay, PLT, because this is the sum up of the half, okay. So that's all for the case of the surface and body force, but actually the surface and body force can be any type of the distributed force. The surface force is maybe the function of X or Y also. If it is a function, so the integration term after we integrate over the length over the surface, and we have to use the integration that is combination with the shape function also. So the value of the equivalent nodal force is will be changed depend on the type of distributed load. Okay. So for this topic, we know that for the metric K, that is we can generally derive it by using metric B, metric D. Okay, metric B and metric D. And metric D. For metric D, if we talking about the plane problem, metric D, we have to concern that it should be two cases. That is maybe the first one, it is the plane stress problem. And the second one, it is a plane strain problem. We have to use the correct metric D that is suitable for the problem that we select. For the case that if we select it for the plane stress metric D that we have to select, it should be for the case of plane stress. Okay. So actually after we manipulate this equation, we can find the explicit expression of the constant strain triangle stiffness metric. That is can be write in this form. This is the explicit formula for the Snippet metric. Okay, but actually I think it's maybe if we write the computer program, so we can use this formula directly, okay, in order to reduce the time of calculation, because you write the formula explicitly, so it's not necessary to use the metric manipulation again. But for calculation by hand for another case that is maybe in general, we can determine it separately for metric B and metric D, and after that we multiply it together by using this equation. That is okay in order to obtain the element stiffness metric of the constant strain triangle. That is depend. It's up to you that you may use this method that you may found that is more convenient for you for any case. But we have to concern that for this case is the explicit expression, right? And one thing that we have to concern is the for the case that this is the explicit formula. This is the explicit formula for the constant strain triangle. Okay, and that is derived by multiply each term of this metric. Okay, together we have this formula. One thing that we have to be careful, that is when we obtain this formula, we have to this formula is for actually this formula is for what? This formula, we consider the metric D that we use for this formula is for the plane strain problem. Okay, so this metric, this formula is for plane strain case. For plane strain case, is for plane strain. Okay, next we apply metric D for plane strain problem. So according to this, we can write the explicit formula. This is for plane strain after we multiply each term from that metric. Okay, but if we would like to derive the explicit value for plane stress, we can do the same thing, but we have to change the metric D into the plane stress problem. Okay, for the plane stress problem, that we for this plane stress. Okay, it's maybe last slide. You may file it in last slide. Okay, and for the explicit formula for the plane stress, we just generally replace the term 1 minus nu by 1, and also for the term of 1 minus 2 nu over 2 by 1 minus nu over 2. Okay, and 1 plus nu multiply with 1 minus 2 nu outside the bracket by this term instead of the equation we obtain the explicit value of explicit formula for the plane stress case also. Okay, And this is a table that is a copy from the from this source from the internet, and it's talking about the Poisson ratio. The Poisson ratio. That's you will see that the Poisson ratio for the general material now. For general material now, actually for the general one, the Poisson ratio normally is this. As we have learned in mechanics of material, is generally come from the 0 to 0.5. For the case that is the general, for the general case of material that is maybe the stiff material, but we have some material also that is like a foam and isotropic lower limit material. For the some case, we found that the Poisson ratio is maybe the negative value also. Okay, that is the some general, some special case for some material. That is the Poisson ratio can be the negative value, and it is the limit to one. It is not exceed one. Okay, but it can be the negative value also. For that case, that is about the material of the type of the foam, for example of the foam. But for the metal or something with or the metal, for the metal case, is normally the Poisson ratio is normally equal to 0.3, and isotropic upper limit. It mean that it is the for the case. It is the ideal case. Upper limit and lower limit. Lower limit is minus one. Upper limit is 0.5. That is the for the case of Poisson ratio equal to 0.5. It means that the is this the ideal material also. It means that the that material is the is this a controlled volume material. It is not change in volume. That is the not happen. For the general material, when it deform, it's normally change in volume also. But if we consider it's the isotropic upper limit or the Poisson ratio equal to 0.5, we may found that we define the case that the material will control value is the control volume case. That is the not in general, okay. So, this example that is from the text of Logan, that is we talking about the plane stress. For this case, is a plane stress, and it's a plane subject to the surface traction on the right hand side. On the right hand side, and the thickness of the plane is equal to 1 inch. Okay, and according to this, we may develop the constant strain triangular element. For this case, we will derive it by using just only two elements, just only two elements like this. Okay, this is a plate problem, not truss problem. Okay, not truss problem, it's the plate. So this is defined as the area of the plate. Okay, in order to identify the problem, this problem, we just discretize it into just the last surface, that is just only two element, one and two. Okay, so you will see that after we obtain the solution, what happened to the obtained solution that we use just only two element of concentric triangle to solve. Okay, so according to this problem, actually it is easy to predict, easy to determine the strength inside any section of the plate based on the general, based on the fundamental mechanics of material formula. We found that the stress distribute over the cross section of the area of the plate is easy to find by the applied surface traction. Okay, the total surface traction over the area divided by the area. So it should be the equivalent with the pressure that we distribute to this surface. Okay, so the stress it should be equal to the traction that we apply. The traction is mean that the surface force. Okay. So, but when we apply when we solve by using the finite element, what happened to that? Okay, this type is to be two element, and we apply boundary condition to node one and node two. According to this, actually it is a fixed support. But when we apply to the concentric triangle, that is the degree of freedom of the concentric triangle, it's just only displacement, it's no angular displacement. It's just only the translation x and y. So it cannot constrain the rotation. Okay, so it means that the support of each node, it just should be just only pin support, just only pin support. If we would like to constrain it both for x and y, for displacement x and y, we just use just only pin support, because it has no moment and it has no rotation, degree of freedom of rotation. We don't have the degree of freedom of rotation at node. Okay. So for this case, we constrain node one and node two with the pin support like this. This is for the case of plane problem. And for this case, it can be simplified to the case of the plate with the fixed support subject to the distributed fraction. Okay, and we distribute the surface traction to the load. It's become 5,000 pounds for each node, apply to node number three and number four. Okay, and then next step we will derive for the stiffness metric. Okay, if we derive the stiffness metric and assemble it together, we should have the equation like this. Okay, when R1x, R1y, R2x, R2y represent reaction at node 1 and node 2 respectively. Okay, and when we apply boundary condition, we will eliminate the row, the first row, second row, third row, and the fourth row. Okay, and we just solve for last four row. Okay, and according to this, okay, so we may starting with derive the element stiffness of the element number one first. For element number one, okay, for the global coordinate system, we set up the node 1, 2, 3, 4, right? This, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. But in local coordinate, we have to mention that the local coordinate, we have to use the sequence of local coordinate in counter clockwise direction. So according to this, this is node 1, node 2, and node 3. This node 1, node 2, and node 3. Node 1, 2, 3 is the value from the global system. But in local, we have to set up which should be node I, J, and M. Okay, for this case, if we set up node I to be node number one, okay, so node J is cannot be node number two. Okay, because it is opposite to the counterclockwise direction. Node J have to be node number three instead. So this is node I, this is node J, and this is node M. Okay, I, J, M. It is in counterclockwise direction. It is counterclockwise direction. And the area for this element, as I mentioned before, if the area is easy to determine, you can determine the area directly from the general formula, a half BH. Okay, right now we have the area already. It's not necessary to use the coordinate of the node to determine the area. For some student, use that formula and you may miscalculation, miss some term, and you obtain the wrong area. So if the area is easy to find, okay, it's not necessary to use the more complicated formula to determine the area, okay? In the same manner, when we derive it in or alpha, beta, and gamma, okay, for this case, we require just only beta and gamma in order to determine the matrix B. Okay, use the coordinate of the element. Okay, that is xi equal to 0, yi equal to 0, xj equal to 20, yj equal to 10, xm equal to 0, ym equal to 10. Substitute into the formula, we obtain beta and gamma. And we can derive for metric B like the equation 6. After that, because it is a plane stress problem, we have to use the metric D like this equation. Okay, you may review a little bit for the previous slide that we already talking about the metric D. For the case of plane stress, we use this, and for the case of plane strain, we have to change a little bit. We have to change the term in this formula. Change some term in this formula. So for this example, it is a plane stress and the Poisson ratio equal to 0.3 and the elastic modulus equal to 30 times 10 power 6 PSI. So according to this constant, we can determine for metric B already. After that, we determine each term, we transpose B. And then in the final, we can determine for metric, stiffness metric K, that is right in equations 12. Okay, this is the element stiffness K. After that, for the element number two, in the same manner, for this case, in global coordinate, the node number is 1, 4, and 3, okay? But in local, we have to define which is node I, node J, and node M. For this case, we define node I over here. So node number 4 should be node J, and node M should be node number 3, okay? In the same manner, when we use the coordinate of node I, node J, node M, for this member, we can, for this element, we can determine for beta and gamma and metric B. After that, we can determine for metric, element stiffness metric of the element number two. Okay, that is solved by we obtain as shown in equation 19. After that, we assemble it together. This is for element number one, and this is for element number two. Okay. Then we assemble it together after we assemble it together okay we can have the global Sydney metric like this okay after that we can write in the general equation like this and then we have to apply boundary condition we apply boundary condition by consider just only last four row okay and then we can solve for the nodal displacement for this case is just at node number 3 and number 4 okay and after that we can determine for the displacement at node after we determine displacement at node what happened the displacement at node we found that we have the displacement in x for node number 3 is equal to 609.6 times 10 power minus 6 inch and node number 4 is equal to 663.7 node number 4 again we have the displacement in y direction also and node number 3 we have the displacement in y direction but actually it's if we compare the solution the finite element solution with analytical one that we normally know that actually the displacement from the formula we can determine directly by using this formula the displacement in x direction is equal to pl over ea for this case p is equal to 10,000 l equal to 20 and ea we obtain the displacement on right hand side it should be 670 times 10 power minus 6 inch and d3y and d4y for the case of analytical solution or the solution for mechanics of material it should be 0 but why the finite element obtain d3y and d4y so what's happened to that okay so according to this case so what happened it means that the solution from the finite element with just only two element what do you think is it enough for predict the correct solution or not okay when we compare with the exact solution it have the error also so if we would like to determine the stress for each element we do the same thing we do the same procedure like a beam and transform them for the stress we using this formula that is the stress is equal to dbd okay metric d big d capital d is the depend on the type of problem for this case it is a plane stress okay after we evaluate this formula we obtain the stress is for the element number one first we can determine the stress in x in y and also for tau xy but actually in this case as we know for mechanical material it should not have sigma y and tau xy right okay sigma x should be the principal stress right but what happened to this okay in the same manner for the element number two also sigma x is become 995 why is not equal to 1000 Actually, the exact solution from the exact solution, it should be equal to 1,000. In the same manner as the element number one, it should be 1,000, but it's, for this case, it's become 1,005. Okay, the sigma y is not equal to zero also for the element number two. And tau xy is not equal to zero. So what happened to the finite element solution? Why we have sigma y and tau xy? Okay, according to this, we can determine for the principal stress, but actually for the case of analytical solution, the principal stress is normally obtained already, it is equal to 1,000 in x direction. But because the solution of the finite element, sigma one is not on the plane that the shear stress is equal to zero. So we would like to determine the principal stress again. Okay, and we found that the principal stress, the maximum principal stress that is in the tension side is equal to 995 psi. That is not equal to 1,000 also. But the sigma 2 that is in another direction, the perpendicular with the direction of sigma 1, it is equal to minus 1.1 psi. Actually, as we mentioned it before, because it is just a simple case, it is a uniaxial problem. So the principal stress should be sigma x that is equal to 1000 psi. But what happened to this problem? That is analytical solution and finite element is not, is different, okay? And this is the angle of principal angle that is actually is not equal to zero, but for in order to simplify the solution, the angle is approximately equal to zero for the case. And we may find that this is not the solution that we obtain from the element, the concentrated triangular element with just only two elements. We found that the solution is not in my opinion, it's maybe not acceptable for this case. Okay, it has the error also. So we may reduce the error from this by using the fine mesh. So we may discretize more than two elements. It's maybe four, more, maybe 16 or something. It depends on you. Okay, but in order to show the hand calculation to obtain more understanding, we just show you just only two elements, okay, as the case study. Okay, and this is the for the case that is we would like to check the for the steel member. For the steel member, we normally use the yield criteria, that is a von Mises criteria, in order to check the yield of the yield of the material. Okay, so we normally call von Mises stress, that is can be determined by using this formula, that is sigma vm subscript vm represent von Mises stress. Okay, we can use equation 37a and 37b. Actually, it should obtain the same value. It should obtain the same value, but why it is different? If you consider the first one, it is a von Mises stress also. But in this formula, it do not have the term of shear stress in this formula. Why is not have shear stress? Because the von Mises stress from this formula is determined from the principal stress. It's determined from the principal stress. sigma 1, sigma 2, and sigma 3 represent the principal stress. So the one mean stress for this formula is determined from the principal plane that has no shear stress. Okay? So for the case that we don't know principal stress, but this is the in general one, we have the state of stress. That is, we have the six components of stress tensor. That is, we have sigma x, sigma y, sigma c, and tau xy, tau yc, and tau cx. Okay? And we do not know sigma 1, sigma 2, and sigma 3 for this case. And we would like to determine the one mean stress by using the state of stress, sigma x, sigma y, sigma c, and tau x, and the shear stress directly. We don't want to transform it to be the principal stress first, and then just determine from the equation A. So we can determine it from the equation B directly if we know the state of stress. That is, we don't know the principal stress, we can use the equation B directly. Okay, it should be obtained the same value of the one mean stress. And we will use this value in order to check with the yield strength of material. If the one mean stress is greater than the yield strength, it means that the member or the plate that we consider it is failed. Okay, because the one mean stress that is occur from that state of stress happen to the member is greater than the yield stress or the yield strength or the strength of the member. So it means that the member is leak in fail. Okay. So that's all for the case of one mean stress. And this is some comments for the concentrain triangular element. Okay, concentrain triangular element is at the limit to for the application also because the distribution of the stress and strain on its element is constant, as its name. Its name is constant strain triangular. So it means that the distribution of the strain and also the stress over the area of the element is constant. So this type of element is not suitable for the case of the bending problem. That the distribution of the stress is not uniform like the uniaxial load. Or the case that the stress distribution is not constant. For any case for that, the constant strain triangular element it may have some problem. That is the signet of the problem of the overall problem is maybe more stiff, or it is stiffer than the actual problem. What does it mean? It means that for this case, the defection that we obtain from the finite element that we use constant strain triangle is maybe smaller than the exact one. Okay, that is not. It is the problem of the constant strain triangle, that is we may call the problem. Sometimes we describe it like the shear locking case. Okay. Okay, and we can solve this problem by using another type of element. That is, we may use the LST instead. That is, we adding the node to each side of the Angola. Okay, so the distributed in strain and in stress is maybe not the constant. Okay, so for the case that we use LST limit instead for the beam bending problem, okay, when you select the element type in commercial software, you have to mention on this also. Okay, constant strain triangular element is the is maybe suitable for some case that is for some case that is you would like to solve for the case that is the not necessary to because the degree of freedom of constant strain triangular is less than LST a lot. Okay, so in order to derive, in order to predict the solution, like the solution that we not want to obtain the precision of that, we can use constant CST first, and in order to finding the trend of solution first, in order to reduce the time, the run, the solution time, the computer time. Okay, but we have to use it. It should be used the mesh when we create the mesh for that case. It should be fine enough in order to obtain the more precise solution. Okay, we will talking about, we mentioned to this problem again when we use the finite element software. Okay, okay, so for today we will have a break a little bit. I will stop record for this clip and we will move to the MATLAB workshop a little bit for one example.